where I'm going to take my text. It says, but thou, when thou prayest, enter into thy closet, and when thou hast shut thy door, pray to thy Father which is in secret. Mm-hmm. And I'll read the rest. It says, and thy Father that seeth in secret shall reward thee openly. On your way down, Father, bless your people as we receive your word. In Jesus' name, amen. On your way down, if you would help me to bring emphasis to the word today by saying, things happen.
Things happen.
In the closet.
In the closet.
Amen.
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 I'm going to do the best I can to preach this morning. I have been carrying this thing in my heart for almost a month now. I don't really know how it's going to come out today. Now, I promise y'all, to our guests, I do know how to put together a message and preach. But the way I feel right now, there's a prophetic unction on me. And I've got to say it exactly as the Spirit of God has given it to me, so I can't do all the formalities and all that stuff. Yeah. I know homiletics, I know hermeneutics, but today I can't do it like that.
All
right. I need hungry folks. Is there anybody in here who's hungry for a word from God? Say it again with me. Things happen.
Things happen.
In the closet.
In the closet.
To my preachers, to our preachers, we have awesome preachers in this church, and those of you that aren't necessarily preachers yet, just listen to this part for just a moment. Preachers, it's very important that when we deliver a message to the people of God, that what we share with them has a purpose and a goal. It does no good for us to just preach to the people of God and give them, you know, what we've heard, but it doesn't, we don't go at it with a goal or with something in mind that we want them to take away from what we've delivered.
Yes.
That is very important. Another thing that I found by the Spirit of God that is very, very important as preachers is that not only should we deliver the message with a goal, but also at the same time, we need to make sure that when we preach, many times, if you listen to a lot of preachers, they're very good at telling us what we should do. Talk to me, somebody. We're good at telling folk what they should do. You need to do this. You need to do that. You ought to be doing this. You ought to be doing that. But the problem is, and this is coming from the pews, talking back to us preachers, they don't just want to know what we ought to be doing, but tell me how to do what you're telling me I ought to be doing. Am I speaking for the people today? Because we hear people tell us, well, you were wrong for this, and you were good for that, and you were bad for that. But tell me, how can I bring about change in my life? Most people don't want to be the way they are. That's the reason why they're coming to church. Now, there are some people that come to church because it's what mama and them taught them to do, and daddy and them taught them to do. But there are some people that come to church because they really want to be changed and transformed, and they need God to speak to their life, to say something to them that is going to transform them forever. I don't know about anybody else, but I didn't come here because I want to be the same.
Yes,
that's right. Amen. Come on.
If I wanted to be the same, I could have stayed home in my bed on a Sunday morning. I can't get a talk back church. I could have watched something on TV if I wanted to be the same. But obviously, if the Lord put something in my belly to make me want to show up in here on a Sunday morning, there's something in me that really wants to change. If I really want to change, tell me, how do I change? Well, let me just tell you, ladies and gentlemen, today, my assignment, my goal is to provoke every believer in this room to go back to the closet.
Yes,
I'm not talking to you up here. To provoke every believer back to the closet.
Yes, sir.
I come to understand it. I've come to understand, ladies and gentlemen, that one of the things that even in the marketing environment, in our everyday society, in our everyday life, what they do for you. Now, you know, in our society, we have a system of exchange. And with our system of exchange, you go into a store, you pick up a candy bar, you give them 50 cents and or a dollar, and you walk out the store with your candy bar. The system of exchange. But in order for them to get you to buy the candy bar, what they watch this. Yesterday, I was in a store on the way back from Nashville. Stopped into a gas station. I had never seen this before, First Lady. But all of the candy bars on the candy bar aisle, they had them lit up. It wasn't just that they were sitting there like normal, like everybody, you know, our regular candy bars. I'm talking about the whole section. They had lights up under the shelf and they were shining down on the candy bar. And something about those lights being on that candy bar made you want to grab something on the shelf. Because they wanted to get your attention. When they market something, they show you, like, you know, they have a little song, Almond Joy's Got Nuts, Mounds Don't. They got the song, they got the little thing on the little commercial where the man comes in and he's being a diva and he's being mean and hateful and fussing, and then they say, here, you need a Snicker bar. Anybody ever seen that commercial? In other words, what they do is they show you the benefits of the item in order for you to want the item. So it does. See, what we got to learn how to do as preachers and in delivering the gospel, and even you as believers, every one of us, when we go out in the community, we got to show people the benefits of what we're offering. Am I talking all right? They need to know the benefits. So when we have preaching moments, Bishop, we've got to use our preaching moments to give people the benefits of what can come out of what we're trying to offer them. So today, if I might, now, can I be honest? This ain't the candy store today.
All right, now.
Everything I have to say won't be sweet. Everything I have to say won't be sweet. See, that's the problem with the church now. We want sweet stuff. But sweet gives you cavities. Sweet messes you up. Sweet will get down in your belly. And my grandma used to call it rock gut. You need something with some nutrients in it. So can I preach some nutrients today? Because I'm talking to the saints of God about going back to the closet. Ladies and gentlemen, it's interesting because when we get to this text that we're looking at, it is actually a continuation of Jesus' sermon on the mount. If you go back into Matthew chapter 5, you'll see where he sat them down on the mountaintop and began to teach them. And he taught them things like how to live, how to be. He taught them what real blessings are. Oh, I can't get no help right there. See, we think because we got a check, we think because you done got married, you think because you done got your little boyfriend, little girlfriend, think because you got a little money in your bank account, that's what it means to be blessed. But then what do we do with the stuff when Jesus turns around and says, blessed are the poor in spirit? Y'all not talking. He says things like, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. You mean to tell me I'm blessed when I'm dealing with troubles? Not helping me right there. He says, blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. You'll never find out that Jesus is that the Holy Spirit is a comforter if you've never had reasons to mourn. If you've never cried, you'll never find him to be a comforter. So you are a blessed individual. If you've ever had to suffer, ever had to cry, okay, let me go a step further. He says, blessed are you when men talk about you, dog you out, put their mouth on y'all, not talking. You mean, wait a minute, we get mad and we got people that got to preach to us about our haters. I don't have time to preach to you about your haters because Jesus already told you you're blessed when you have haters. So why do we have to preach to you every week about, well, shake your haters off and you don't even worry about you. No, the Bible says, I need my haters because my haters are a place of blessing for me. Blessed are ye when men speak ill of thee and revile thee and talk evil of you. You got to learn what it means to be blessed beyond the check. Sometimes the bad stuff is really the blessing.
Amen.
Not only does Jesus teach them about what real blessing is, he gives them the revelation and tells them that you are also salt and light.
Yeah.
I don't have time to get too deep into that, and that'll take away my whole message. But saints of God, we're supposed to be salt and light. Salt is a preservative. We don't know much about it now, but they used to have what they call salt-cured ham. And what they would do is they would put that salt on there and rub that salt in real good because it would help to preserve the ham. Any environment that you are in, number one, you ought to set the flavor for the environment. And number two, you ought to be a preservative for the environment. Some of y'all ain't know, you don't know where to shout because God is using you. The reason why some of your family members aren't dead yet is because you're around and you're the salt of God. The reason why they're still making it is because they live, they're around you, and they're connected to you, and you're the salt of the earth, and because you've been praying, and you've been interceding, and you've been covering them, the reason why they're still making it is because you've been holding on for them. Salt, 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 salt. And then he says, you are the light of the world. Now, don't just look at it from the fact that I'm supposed to be a Christian and shine my light. But light is a thing of revelation. Light is a thing that brings illumination. When you turn light on in the room, if the room is dark, you can't see what's in the room. But when you turn light on, it brings illumination and it brings revelation. It reveals everything that's in the room. When you begin to walk in the light and be the light of God in the earth, ladies and gentlemen, people will see Christ in you.
Amen.
It will reveal what, preach on. Light reveals darkness. Light is the great revealer of darkness, because if you don't have an opposing force to darkness, all you know is darkness. So you need light to prove that there is darkness. And here's where I got a problem. I'm going to get to my test, but here's where I got a problem, Elder Larry, is that the church has forgotten what it means to be light. So there is no distinction between light and darkness. Everybody just looking just the light now. The church looks like the world. The world looks like the church. And we've gotten to a place where anything goes. And we have forgotten the commandment of the Lord that we need to be changed. We need to be sanctified. We need to be purified. And we've made the excuse that that's just my struggle. But my question is, how much progress have you made with your struggle? I'm not talking to me up here. How much progress have you made with your struggle? And please understand, I'm not just talking about sexual sin. I'm talking about sin from every end of the spectrum. Because some people got attitude problems. Some people can't forgive folks. Oh, God, have mercy. You, every one of us in here got something that we call a struggle. But my question is, how far have you come with your struggle? Is it really a struggle, or is it really an excuse? Okay, move on. Salt and light. Then he gives them a revelation of the law about adultery, the law about divorce, the law, all these laws about love and everything. And then he moves to chapter 6, and he opens chapter 6, ladies and gentlemen, talking about giving alms. He opens chapter 6 talking about giving alms, meaning giving to the poor. Oh, Jesus. God, you mean to tell me after I give all my tithes and my offering, I'm supposed to give some more? Ladies and gentlemen, perhaps the reason why you're not as blessed as you should be is because you've not listened to God when it comes to giving to people who've got less than you.
Come on.
I mean, I'm talking about the book. I didn't say it. He said, and when you give your alms. Alms is when we bless people who are less fortunate. And let me just do it like this. See, you don't have to have your church name on the billboard because you doing some alms. Lord have mercy. Sometimes we need, as a church, we need to stop looking at whether it's our church doing it. If somebody down the street is helping the community and doing something to be a blessing, we might need to throw on our t-shirts and our jeans and go out there and say, how can we help you? Kingdom Life's name doesn't have to be on it. My name doesn't have to be on it. I just want the name of Jesus to be, oh God have mercy, to be lifted and to be glorified. What are you doing it for?
Come on.
He says, when you give your alms, don't do it to be seen of men. When you go bless somebody, don't go broadcasting that I bless them. Can I go a little further? Don't go back and hold it over their head that you blessed them. You know, that's what we like to do because Jesus, I got to dig right here. If there ever comes a moment where you need them to do something for you, and maybe they're not physically able to do what you need them to do, or they got something else going on, or they just don't want to do it. See, that's where we get mad, if they just don't want to do it. Well, you don't remember. Well, she don't remember when she was down and out and she was having problems and I was there for her. Well, the question is, what did you do it for in the first place? The question is, can you be a blessing if they don't bless you back? Meanness and their nastiness, they're not going to do anything back for you. Sometimes God will make you bless folk that you don't like. Sometimes God will make you bless people that you just don't like. None of y'all. Y'all love everybody, like everybody, everything's cool. But Jesus tells him, he says, when you give your alms, do it in secret. And your Father who sees in secret will reward you openly. Can I say something right here? Some folk wonder why you're as blessed as you are. But it's because of what you do behind the scenes. Some people don't understand, Sister Rosalind, why the favor of God is on you like it is. When everything should be shut off, cut off, gone under, the favor is on you. That's because they don't understand that you fixed a meal for somebody who was hungry when you really didn't have a whole lot yourself. You had to divide the portions out and say, baby, we're going to eat a little less today so we can help somebody else eat. Y'all not talking. When you went in your kitchen cupboard and pulled out the canned vegetables and things and took them to a family that was in need. They didn't know you were doing that behind the scenes. But that's why you're as favored and as blessed as you are. It's what you did behind the scenes that got it done for you. Not what you did before the people.
Thank you, Lord.
Y'all gonna let me preach like I said. So, I noticed as we look through the entire book of Matthew chapter 6, what we find out is that Jesus spends a lot of time. He talks about three different areas. He talks about alms, then he talks about prayer, and then he talks about fasting. He talks about those three areas, saying that when you, when you give your alms, not if,
when.
When you pray, when you Oh, y'all know the cuss word. Y'all know the cuss word I'm about to use. Fast.
Uh-oh.
I can't get no help. So y'all looking at me funny. Y'all looking at me funny. Y'all know that's a cuss word in church. Let the man of God call a fast for the church. Lord have mercy. People find all kind of excuses as to why we can't do this and why we can't do that. I can't go on that fast with the church. I can't. Listen, well, let's not even talk about when the church gets called on a fast. When was the last time you've been on a fast? Notice Jesus wasn't just talking to the whole church. He says, when you fast.
You.
Okay, I'm going to leave fasting alone today, y'all, because y'all not going to like me. That's all right, I don't care. Y'all know I'm going to tell it anyhow. In case y'all don't know, we have fun while we get in this. We have fun in here. But ladies and gentlemen, here's the thing. Let me go back to my point. And one thing I noticed in the fact that each one of these things that Jesus talks about in Matthew chapter 6, he deals with two things. Pay attention to this. Write this down. He deals with number one, motive. Uh-huh. Number two, he deals with method. Uh-huh. He deals with motive and method. You have to ask yourself, what is your motive for doing what you do? And I want to hone in on this area called prayer. Because he says when you pray, number one, he starts talking about, he says, don't do it like the hypocrites do.
Right here.
Yes, Lord, help me right here. I got to get in this right here. Because, see, here, now we have our definition of the hypocrite, but let me give you an even more base idea of the hypocrite. The hypocrite is somebody who can do it better out here than what they do it at home. You know how, Lord, if I hand you a microphone, you'll get on this microphone and you'll get to praying. Oh, my God. And you know how to tune up just right. And you say, Father God, in the name of Jesus, we need you to move. And because people move by emotions and what they hear, you think you've done something because you know how to pray in public. And your motive is moving the people, and you think you're moving God. But the reality is you're not moving God here if you never move him there. Not moving God in church among everybody if your prayer life behind the scenes is nothing.
Amen.
But see, the lie that the church has developed, many people have developed this mindset, well, I pray. But do you really have a private devotion with God? Well, when I'm in my car on my way to work, I pray. But do you really have a private devotion with God?
Come on.
Do you know some of the most powerful people never have to raise their voice to pray? I'm not talking.
Come on.
Some of the most powerful people never have to raise their voice because even in the secret place, God has heard them. God is used to their voice. So the simple whisper of their voice is enough to summon heaven to their side. The simple whisper of their voice is enough to summon heaven to their side. Now the problem, here's where I got to work. Here's where I light up the candy bar section, y'all. I got to light up and say that one of the benefits of going in the secret place is that you find that God hears you and you develop a communication line with God that moves heaven and earth on your behalf. So, I looked at this. So when you do it, don't do it like the hypocrites. Don't be the person who can pray real good up here, but you don't touch heaven at home.
Amen.
Let's go deeper. Can we walk a little deeper, y'all? He says, but when you pray, when pray, enter into your closet. Somebody say closet.
Closet.
There was a word for the word closet. The etymology as it goes back is tamion, which means a store room. Store room. In the Hebrew culture, it was a place where they would store up things in their house for protection of the thing. They would use, watch this, and it was not on the outside, and it wasn't in one of the outer rooms that they would store stuff up. It was in an inner chamber. An inner room where they would begin to store stuff up. In an inner chamber. And as I begin to think about this thing, it messed me up, y'all. It messed me up when I started thinking about this inner chamber, because the inner chamber and storing things up. My grandma used to sing a song, say, "I'm sending up my timber." It was a place where you would store, you would send them, you would put together, and you would pack on what you were building. You would pack on what you were saving. You would pack on what was going to sustain. Y'all not going to talk right here. You would pack on what was going to sustain you. Where did they put it? In the inner storeroom, inner chamber. You want to find the thing that's going to sustain you? It's going to happen in the inner chamber.
All right.
Whoa. That's good.
So, when I thought about this, first lady, I was laying in my bed last night and God began to talk to me. And I began to think about the inner chamber. The inner chamber became really powerful to me because he related it for me to the Old Testament tabernacle of Moses. Are y'all with me?
Yes.
In the tabernacle of Moses, pay close attention right here, you need this. There was the outer court.
Yes.
Then you had the inner court.
Uh-huh.
And then you had the Holy of Holies.
Yes.
Somebody say that with me. You had the outer court, the inner court, and you had the Holy of Holies. Let me say it one more time. Come on, say it with me. You had the outer court, you had the inner court, and then you had the Holy of Holies. Now watch this. In the outer court, it was daylight. You had three revelations of light that took place here, here, and here. Everybody with me?
Yeah.
Outer court was daylight shining.
Uh-huh.
Outer court was where the sun shined down.
Yeah.
And there were sacrifices that were offered on the outer court that would allow you to go into the inner court. Ladies and gentlemen, your flesh has to go on the altar.
Uh-huh.
Amen. Come on.
My.
We don't talk like that anymore in church.
Yeah.
Putting our flesh on the altar, because we love this new grace message that lets us get by with anything and not ever have to mortify the deeds of our flesh. But that book still says mortify the deeds. That means violently putting to death whatever you got to do. Kill your flesh. I'm not just talking to you sitting in the pew. I'm talking to Long standing in the pulpit. I'm talking to First Lady. I'm talking to Bishop. No disrespect. I'm talking to everybody in here, because the book does not make an exclusion based on our title, based on our position. The book makes no exclusions. When it says mortify the deeds of your flesh, whether you got a collar on or whether you stand at the front door or whether you don't do anything in the church at all, it still tells us mortify the deeds of our flesh. You want to go off. You want to flip out on them because they made you mad. No, you got to mortify.
Come on, Lord.
Deeds of your flesh. Your husband made you mad. You don't want to cook dinner for him. You need to mortify. You can't get nobody. Deeds of your flesh. Hey. Mortify. Okay. Leave that alone. Leave that alone. Leave that alone. Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. You got some stuff in your phone. Leave it alone. Leave it alone. That didn't come from your husband or your wife.
Watch out now.
They in your inbox and you entertaining them. Can't hear nobody.
Come on, come on.
They on your Snapchat and you entertaining them.
You hear me?
Mortify.
Yes,
deeds of your flesh. Okay. All right. Leave it alone. Leave it alone. But ladies and gentlemen, when I think about that, it says now watch. In the outer court, there was daylight. And can I submit to you that's where most believers live? Pay close attention. That is where most believers live on the outer court.
Yes, sir.
In the outer court, you have daylight. But here's the problem. You can become easily distracted, man of God, by the things that are going on around you. You can still see everything that's going on in the camp when you're in the outer court. You can still hear what's going on in the camp when you're in the outer court. And that's where a lot of people live, and that's why we're so defeated, because we get distracted by the stuff that is going on around us because we stay in the outer court. Is helping somebody right here.
Yes.
Do you see you this morning?
Yes.
It takes sacrifice to move beyond the outer court. I don't want to stay in the outer court. Outer court is not the place of the greatest blessing. You know why we're living in such a hit and miss body of believers, a hit and miss church world today, where we're not seeing very many miracles anymore? It's because so many people are living in the outer court.
Yes.
Jesus.
Last time I checked, the Bible says these signs shall follow them that believe. In my name, they shall cast out devils. In church, we don't cast out devils anymore like that. Probably because we don't have the discerning to discern what is and what ain't the devil in the first place.
Come on now. Come on.
We don't have, because we've not been in a place to hear and have a sensitive heart to know what is and what ain't the devil.
Yes.
So we don't cast out devils anymore. When was the last time, as a believer, you laid hands, you walked in a room with a confidence. You walked in a room with a confidence that when you laid hands on somebody, they were going to be healed.
Uh-huh.
Right.
Oh, we said, well, I'm gonna go out to the hospital and I'm going to pray for them.
Y'all know I'm telling the truth.
Come on. Well, I'm going to go out there and I'm going to have prayer. I'm not going out there just to have prayer. I can pray from home.
That's right.
I'm going out there to take my bottle of oil. If I got one, and if I ain't got one, I'm going to use the oil that's on my life, lay my hands on that sick person with an expectation that they're going to recover. Not necessarily in my time, but surely in God's time, he's going to raise them up.
Come on,
right. Now listen, I'm not the healer, you're not the healer, but the problem is if you don't go in with an expectation of the healer doing what the healer does, then you're not going to see healing happen.
That's right.
You're not going to see healing happen if you don't go in with an expectation that the healer is the healer and you are a vehicle, Minister Lisa, that is carrying the healer with you, so you have the authority and the power to lay hands on the sick and watch them recover. Listen, I'm talking to everybody. I don't care if you have a title or not. Every one of us He says these signs will follow them that believe in my name. They'll cast out devils, lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover. And if they drink any deadly thing or eat any deadly thing, it shall not harm them. They shall tread upon serpents and scorpions. We're not even treading on serpents and scorpions because people that bite us, people that hurt us, we don't know how to shake them off in the fire. We get down for 3 and 4 days when somebody dogs us out. But I'm not talking. Okay, here we go. Let me go further. Let me hurry up because y'all getting bored. So what happens is we got to get to this place where we move from the outer court because we've lived in the outer court and we got too much stuff distracting us and we think we can see it better than God as long as we stay out here and keep a watch out on things.
Come on.
Tell somebody and say it's time to go deeper.
All right.
So then you go in from the outer court, you had daylight. In the inner court, you had what was called candlelight. Thy word.
Talk
to me, somebody. Thy word have I hidden in my heart that I might not sin against thee. Thy word is a lamp. Come on. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light to my path. It represents the candlelight of the inner court. It reveals the word of God. If you really get in it, it will reveal you to you. Of us are looking at the word to give it to somebody else and show them about them. But when was the last time you looked at the word to find out about you and find your messy self and find your nasty flesh and stop justifying and stop pacifying the stuff that's going on the inside of you and acting like you bet, oh Lord Jesus, have mercy, acting like you better than everybody else because your sin ain't as big as theirs. Forgiveness. It doesn't matter whether you got an anger problem. Whatever your stuff is, all unrighteousness is sin. And every one of us needs God to deliver us from ourselves. And you need the word of God to step in your heart and awaken your heart and purify. Somebody, yes. Come sit down. We have some more to go.
Yes, ma'am.
I feel God in here, y'all. I feel him in here. This ain't no cute message today. Yeah. This ain't a cute one today. See, the level of people that can come into the inner court is different from the folk that can be in the outer court.
Yes, yes.
Only the priests could enter into the inner court.
Yes. Uh-huh.
When you have made the decision that you belong to God and God is yours and you're his, you become a priest. Do I have Bible to back me up? Sure I do. It says you are a peculiar people. Come on, Bible readers, talk to me. A royal priesthood. Say somebody, tell somebody and say, I am a priest.
I am a priest.
So I've got access to a place in God. But if you're a priest, why are you walking around like a pauper?
Come on, Lord.
If you are a priest, why are you walking around with a poverty mentality?
Yes, Lord.
Okay, leave it alone, Mom.
Come on.
Listen to this. So, told you in the inner court, there's candlelight. This is where I gotta hang my hat. This is what messes me up, Bishop. When you go beyond that second place, there was a veil. Now, please understand, don't let folks sing any more songs to you about going beyond the veil. Y'all quiet.
Come on.
Stop letting these folks sing these songs to you about going behind the veil. You cannot go behind the veil anymore as a New Testament believer. You know why you can't? Because there ain't one. Did y'all hear what I said? I said there ain't one. I know that's not good English. I'm sorry, y'all. I know it's not good English. There ain't one. When Jesus died on that cross, he gave us access to the Father because the veil of the temple was rent, was torn, not from bottom to top, so man could say they did it. It was torn from top to bottom as a sign that God was now granting us access to everything in the most holy place. I'm about to lose it up here, y'all.
Come on.
You know why? I'm about to lose it in here. Because when you step into the holy of holies or the most holy place, now understand, for the sake of my analogy today, they had to go beyond a curtain. Watch this, where it should have been dark. There was no daylight in the holy of holies. There was no candlelight in the Holy of Holies. So behind that curtain, technically, it should have been dark. But when you go into the most holy place, into the Holy of Holies, ladies and gentlemen, where it should have been dark, it ain't dark in there, because that's the place where the light of God is the only thing you see. And when evidence. already done and recognize it as the evidence that God is with you. Not only is it evidence, but pay attention to this. Aaron's rod didn't bud while it was on the tree still connected. Aaron's rod budded when it was down and cut down. There's no tree that should bud and produce almonds when it's been cut away, but it's a sign that God is showing up miraculously for his people. God have mercy. We are now living in a place, in a time where God is declaring to you, I'm about to show up miraculously for some people. I'm going to blow your mind for some of my people that will go beyond the norm and come into the Holy of Holies. Folk don't know what to shout, because I just declare God has promised I'm getting ready to release miraculously in the life where things will cut off. I'm getting ready to start causing to flourish. When things were cut down, I'm getting ready to cause it to flourish. When things were broken off, I'm getting ready to cause it to flourish. You ought to get excited over the fact that God's getting ready to cause your life to flourish. He's getting ready to cause your life to be blessed. He's getting ready to cause you to see the evidence. Everybody doesn't get to see it, but he's going to give you evidence as a reminder that I'm with you, that I'm not going to leave you, and I'm still the God of the supernatural. Y'all handle a little bit more. So next thing you see is worship. Next thing you see in the Holy of Holies is worship. Because you got two angels whose wings are touching one another. It's the power of agreement. Listen. Listen, I don't have to have everybody. I don't have to have the whole world to come into agreement with me. All I need is one or two people who can agree and faith with me, and I'll be all right. I need some folk that know how to walk in worship with me. I need somebody that knows how to touch wings with me. I need some folk that know how to touch. If you can agree as touching anything, and all I need is one more person. Because the Bible says out of the mouth of two or three witnesses, let every word be established. I need somebody who can agree with me. Touch somebody around you and tell them I need somebody who can agree with me. Don't just agree for my blessing, but agree with me in worship. It's bigger when you start agreeing in worship. Lord, have mercy. Oh, help me, God. Oh, magnify the Lord what with me. I need you to agree with me in worship. Agree with me that God is good. Agree with me that he is awesome. Agree with me that he is wonderful. Agree with me that there's nobody greater than our God. Agree with me. That's why when I come here some Sundays, I keep saying, I need you to open your mouth. I need you to open your mouth. And I'm pulling on folk to open your mouth because I need you to agree. Only when there is agreement can there be a move of God. I'm not talking. Only when there's agreement can there be a real move of God. And ladies and gentlemen, if God has declared a thing, if you can't get nobody else to agree with you, you go ahead and high five God, because his work is forever settled in the heaven. And say, Father, I agree with your word. Father, I agree with what you said. Father, I receive what you spoke. Father, your word is true. Father, you cannot lie. Father, you got my back. Father, you're my everything. Father, you're in control. Father, you're going to fix it. Father, I already got it. Father, I'm already healed. Yeah.
I got to go.
Yes, sir.
Just a little bit more. Just a little bit more. In that place, in the Holy of Holies, in the secret place, in the secret place, there's no outside distraction. in the secret place.
Yeah.
I'm going to hit this and I'm going to run, because if I get stuck here, I'm going to be in trouble. There was one more thing that was in that Holy of Holies.
Yeah.
It was the blood.
Yeah.
I got about five folks that got happy on that. I said it was the blood. It was the blood. I can't enter in to the holy place without the blood. Oh, I don't know about anybody else, but I thank God for the
blood. Thank you, Lord. Gotta go. Lord.
Thank you.
Can I please preach this out, y'all?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Watch this. Now, in the Holy of Holies, one portion of it, when you looked at the Ark of the Covenant, where they put the blood, it was called the mercy seat.
Yes.
It was called what?
The mercy seat.
And that's where a lot of believers like. We like the mercy seat.
Uh-huh.
Come on, come on.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
We love the mercy seat.
Yes.
But that same place, Minister Sandra,
yes,
was also called the throne of grace. It was also called the throne of grace.
Yes,
it's not just the seat of mercy. When you think about a throne involves power and authority. It means I'm giving God and expose on God the power and the authority that he has. Wait a minute. The throne of what? Grace. Grace is not just getting you by. Grace is the supernatural power of God that makes you an overflow. Oh, Lord Jesus. Somebody ought to help me right there. Tell somebody, say, grace is,
grace is
the supernatural, enabling power
enabling
of God
in your life
to overcome anything that comes. Grace is not just undeserved favor. Grace is the power of God on the inside of you that causes you to be an overcomer. The problem is most of us don't really want to struggle or contend for the faith. We want to just keep being who we are. Well, I come to talk to somebody in here that says, I'm going before the throne of
grace.
Can I go to Hebrews? Now y'all see where it is. I go humbly before the throne of grace that I may obtain mercy and find grace to help in the time of need. The Bible says, go boldly. Ladies and gentlemen, do you not understand that it was the blood of the Lamb of God that was sprinkled on the mercy seat, sprinkled on the throne of grace, that allows me to enter in with boldness into the throne room of God, and I can walk in there boldly, and I will find grace to help and obtain mercy in my time of need. Somebody ought to praise him that it's not just the mercy seat, but it's the throne of grace. Was dark.
Yes.
Other than the light of the glory of God, the Shekinah of God would show up.
Yes.
When that blood was purified, when the people were purified, when they went in and that blood was placed, the Bible said the light of the glory of God would show up in there.
Come on.
So, God. He spoke to the priest. Watch this, minister. God spoke to the priest from the holiest of holies.
Come on.
He speaks to you.
Yes.
In the place behind where the curtain was.
Yes.
Y'all feel me now?
Yes.
He speaks directly to the priest, to the high priest.
Come on.
From behind that curtain.
Yes.
Where everybody else can't be.
Yes.
Where they cannot be exposed to all the other elements that are going on in the camp at the moment.
Yeah.
Sometimes you got to shut your phone off.
Yeah, that's right.
Amen.
Sometimes you got to let Facebook go.
Yeah.
No, not talking. Sometimes you got to put your Snapchat down.
Uh-huh.
Sometimes you got to leave your Twitter alone.
Yeah.
And for those of y'all that don't have any of those, but you like to watch the news, sometimes you got to leave the news alone. God says, I need to know how much space you're making for me.
I gotta hurry up.
Listen, God says, I want to know how much space you're gonna make for me. How much you gonna give me? How much space are you gonna give me in your life today? I need closet sense, is what God is saying. So I don't want you living by daylight anymore, by living by what you can see. I don't want you living by what you can see. I don't want you living. Tell somebody, say, I'm not living by what I can see anymore. I'm gonna live by the light of God, and God's gonna speak to me. See, it's one thing when God speaks by his word, but it's a whole other thing when God begins to talk to you mouth to mouth, ear to ear, and you begin to hear his voice speaking into your life. That's when you gotta get in the hole. Do y'all not know that that's when power is gonna break out in the church? Power is gonna break out in the church when the saints go back to the closet. I'm going to close it here. I know there's a whole lot of people that are coming out of the closet. Well, ladies and gentlemen, I need to find out, is there anybody in this room that says, God, I'm going back to the closet. I've allowed too many things to pull me away. And Jesus said, when you go in the closet, shut the door. I don't want you distracted by the stuff that's going on in your family. I don't want you distracted by stuff that's going on in your finances. I don't want you distracted by all the other things that are happening. I need you to be in there with me, because in the secret place, he that dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. He that goes into the closet and shuts the door, it might seem dark, that if you stay in the closet, in the secret place, his glory, the light of God's glory is going to show up in your life. The light of God's glory is going to illuminate your situation. When you don't know what to do, he's going to show up for you. He's going to speak to you. He's going to say what you need to hear. He's going to tell you where to go. He's going to tell you how to do it. He's going to give you the strategy in the secret place. And sometimes you can't go physically into your closet and shut your physical door. Sometimes you got to go in the bathroom and work and shut the door. Sometimes you got to go on your break and sit down in your car and shut the door and say, God, I'm coming in here with only one focus. You, I want more of you. Let them be in this place. Not my will, but your will be done. Hey, will the saints go back to the closet? Things happen when you shut the door. Tell somebody, y'all know I don't do a whole lot of them, but just tell somebody else around you and say, neighbor, isn't it time that you shut the door? Tell that neighbor, say, neighbor, things happen when you shut the door. And there came a day when the son died. The Bible said the prophet went back to the woman's house, went up in the chamber on the prophet's bed where she laid her baby. Watch this, y'all. And the Bible says that he shut. Y'all gonna help me preach this. The Bible said he shut the door. And the Bible said, and then he prayed. When across somebody else's body. That's not normal. But he laid on the boy's body, mouth to mouth, eye to eye, and he began to lay on him. The Bible said his body became warm. Bible says he got up again and he walked around. He walked around to and fro. He came back in, shut the door, and got back on him again. When he got on him the second time, the Bible says that he began to sneeze seven times. The boy got warm the first time, but when he came back again, the boy came back to life. I need to know today, closet saints, you got a tenacity that says that it doesn't happen the first time. I'm going to hang in there until I see what I believe God for. I'm not going to be moved by what I see. But dead boy came back to life behind a closed door. All the same things happen.
Yes, I do.
In the closet.
Yes, sir.
I'm going back to
the closet.
Do I have about five people in here that got what I've been trying to tell y'all this whole message? I'm going back to the closet. I've been too disturbed by stuff that's been happening in my life. I've been too disturbed by what's been going on with my family. I've been too disturbed by everything else. But today, I'm leaving it all behind. And as of today, I am going back to the closet. Might not be able to see my way, but I'm going back.
Yes, Lord. Hallelujah.
I'm done.
I'm done.
I'm going back to the closet.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
My.
I've been too distracted by the cares of life.
Yes.
Now, if I didn't preach to anybody else, I'd just say I preached to me.
Yeah.
You know,
preach to me too.
I'm going back to the closet.
Yes, sir.
Oh, I'm about to see some stuff happen now.
Yes, sir.
So I'm going back to the closet.
Yes, sir.
They won't like me because I can't talk to them all the time.
Yes,
sir. I'm going back to the closet.
Yes, sir.
Oh, you think you all that now?
No.
No, baby, it's not that I think I'm all that. No. It's just that I learned that my power comes from
the closet. Oh, yes, sir.
Yes, Lord.
Thank God.
Yes, Lord. Thank you.
Do you not understand? Your inner strength really comes
from the closet. My.
You're not strong out there until you master in there.
Amen.
Come on.
Yeah.
Very true.
Everybody's standing. I'm done.